Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Elhamdülillahi Rabbil alemin. Vessalatu vesselamu ala Resulina Muhammedin ve ala alihi ve sahbihi ecmain. Rabbi şrah li sadri ve yessir li emri ve hlul ukdeten min lisani yefkahu kavli. Dear students, we were talking about this chapter, making the Quran accessible to contemporary Muslims. And we talked about Ebul Ala el-Mevdudi from Pakistan. And then İzzet Derveze in Syria. Today we will talk about Seyyid Kutup. Who is Seyyid Kutup? Let's see it in Wikipedia. Okay, it's ready now. Seyyid Kutup. İbrahim Hüseyin Şadli Kutup, his father's name, and he was born in 1906 in Egypt. He died in 1966, Egyptian Muslim, okay, Sunni Muslim, this Shafi'i madhab. And he was interested in Islam politics, Quranic exegesis. His famous idea is his comment on Jahiliyyah, how Muslims should see Jahiliyyah, and his famous book, Milestones in the Shade of the Quran. This book was translated into Turkish. Many books of Seyyid Kutup were translated into Turkish. Also, his Quran exegesis in the Shade of the Quran was translated, and I think it is the best seller, his Quran exegesis in Turkey, if we considered other Quran exegesis. Seyyid Kutup, Fi Zilal al-Quran, his uncompromising commitment to his view of Islam. He was strict in his ideas, the author wants to say, to establish Islam as the dominant socio-political force in Muslim societies. He wanted to establish an Islamic state in Muslim countries. Kutup's work, the author says, divorced from standard exegetical tradition. He would like to say that Seyyid Kutup's way of commenting on the Quranic verses is different from the traditional Quran exegesis. I don't think so. We can. Just before we have seen that in Wikipedia, he was Shafi'i and he is from Ahl-i Sunnah. So we can say that his Quran exegesis is very different from the Quran exegesis tradition. He has got some different ideas. Every mufassir, every Quran exegete has got different opinions. He refuses to follow any early approach to tafsir. I don't think so. Sometimes I said he has got different ideas, but it doesn't mean that he didn't consider a Muslim tradition exegesis. It is perhaps this feature of the tafsir, the basis of for the wide acceptability of Zilal among many Muslims. Muslim youths all over the world considered his tafsir. They read it because he tried to show how to live in accordance with Quranic teaching. He says, especially Muslim Brotherhood and similar movements. Considered, yes, in all over the world, Muslims read his exegesis. Today, they are reading as well, but especially in Egypt, he was became influential. Muslim Brotherhood, today, in Mısır, this organization is available, but it was prohibited by the Sisi's regime. Sisi's After the Sisi made a coup in Egypt, and the leaders of the Muslim Brotherhood are in prison. Some of them were killed by the decision of the court. With the decision of the court. Okay. Limiting the concept of revelation, according to classical principles of jurisprudence, usul al-fiqh, revelation consists of both recited and unrecited version. Wahy matlu, wahy ghayru matlu. Two kinds of wahy are available, they say. What does it mean? Wahy matlu is the Quran, they say. Wahy ghayru matlu is the traditions of Prophet Muhammad. So Muhammad, peace be upon him, gets two kinds of wahy, inspiration. One is available in the Quran and one is out of the Quran. It's an approach. Some Muslim scholars think so. Some say no, the obligatory one is available in the Quran. He didn't get any inspiration out of the Quran. It doesn't matter. It is not obligatory as the Quran. Something so. Hadith, the sayings and deeds of the Prophet considered as inspiration from God. Some Muslim scholars think so. Whatever Prophet Muhammad says came from Allah. They think so. But it's a generalization. Hadith Qudsi, they say, and some scholars studying on the Prophet's traditions say so. But some says Hadith Qudsi is from Allah. What about the other traditions of Prophet Muhammad? No, they are from him. He said so. There are two categories. Hadith are not considered the word of God. Yes, some consider that. They don't say that the Prophet's sayings are from Allah, but they are from him. He says so. And some say, no, whatever he says is from Allah. The recited revelation, that is the Quran, is superior. Yes, it has got an upper position. The wahi in the Quran, it has got upper position. And according to scholars who consider that the sunnah, the hadith, the traditions of Prophet Muhammad are also an inspiration from God, they consider it in the second level. Ghazali, he died in 505, according to Hijri calendar. According to him, God has but one word which differs in the mode of its expression. What does he want to say? God sent his word to Prophet Muhammad. It doesn't matter. It came as Quran and it came as the wahi out of the Quran. They are both came from Quran and but they differs. Their way of coming are different. Hadith were considered wahi based on interpretation of the Quranic verse. What is their proof? The ones who say that the Prophet's traditions are from Allah as well, what are their proof from the Quran? وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيُ يُوحَىٰ عَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَىٰ. These verses are considered as proof. It is no less than inspiration sent down to him. Although this Quranic verse is about the Quran, because Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was a man like us. So he learned to speak and he started to speak as well. So he was saying like us, whatever he wants. But the Quran is different. So In these verses, Allah Teala talks about the Quran, not all of Prophet Muhammad's traditions. The Quran is not from his wish. He doesn't present his own philosophy, his own teachings, but the Quran, Allah Teala sent it. These verses are about this. But some scholars say no, like Ghazali. Prophet Muhammad got inspiration from Allah, and those inspirations are not only available in the Quran, but out of the Quran as well. His traditions are the proof of that. It is no less than inspiration sent to him. Okay, such a view are good God's revelation and hence eternally valid. So if we say that the Quran and the Prophet's traditions are all from Allah, it means that both are valid to the hereafter. Is it true? Somewhat yet. Yes, it's true, we can say. But from the aspect of authenticity, the Quran is not equal to the Prophet's traditions. Why? Because the Quran is mutawatir, certain book. Prophet Muhammad memorized it, and people from his companions, Sahaba, memorized it. Also, they wrote the Quran. But what about the traditions of Prophet Muhammad? Was it the same? No, it is different. It is less reliable when we consider the Quran. They are not equal. We can say the Prophet's traditions can be helpful to understand the Quran. The hadith would restrict the freedom of Muslim thinkers, the author says. Is it true? I don't think so. I have said just before. The Prophet's traditions can help us in order to understand the Quran better, because the Prophet Muhammad explained some Quranic verses. Through the Prophet's traditions, we can understand the society very well. The author emphasizes it very much. The contextual approach is nice, he considers. So from this aspect as well, the Prophet's traditions are helpful. But if we know certainly that the Prophet's traditions were transmitted, which were transmitted by Muslim scholars, muhaddithin, are not reliable, are not true, are contradictory with the Quran, now we can say that the Prophet Muhammad didn't say so, didn't do like that. We can say so. But the traditions of Prophet Muhammad keep us away from the Quran, we can't say. Hadith are at times contradictory. Yes, there are some contradictory traditions of Prophet Muhammad. We can solve this problem by considering the Quranic verses. If there are two traditions of Prophet Muhammad and they are contradictory, which one is true according to Quran? We say, okay, Prophet Muhammad said so. Also, maybe Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, made something, and then, for example, 10 years later, he did something different. So because of this difference, people can think that they are contradictory, but if we consider the time and place, in this context, he did so, in that context, he did so, we can say. So sometimes contradictory situations can be solvable. A number of Muslims in the modern period rejected the view that hadith were part of the revelation. Yes, some Muslim thinkers, scholars think so. Prophet Muhammad got
divine inspiration from Allah, and they are all available in the Quran. And others are his sayings, his own ideas, etc., his own approach. For example, if the author wants to say that if we say Prophet Muhammad said and did everything as Allah Ta'ala showed his way, and whatever he said, whatever he did, is strictly related to the Allah's words in the Quran and out of the Quran. It doesn't matter. He says, no, there are some problems if we consider this approach true. What, for example, Battle of Badr. What happened in the Battle of Badr? Prophet Muhammad took some prisoners. And Allah accepted this one? No. مَا كَانَ لِنَبِيٍ أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُ أَسْرَى حَتَّى يُثْخِنَ فِي الْأَرْضِ تُرِيدُونَ عَرَضَ الدُّنْيَا وَاللّٰهُ يُرِيدُ الْآخِرَةِ وَاللّٰهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ It is not for any prophet to have captives until he had made slaughter, kill in the land. He will get the victory over the non-believers in a war for justice. Allah Ta'ala says, you desire the lure of this world, and Allah desires for you the hereafter. And Allah is mighty. Why? So there is a criticism here. Why Allah Ta'ala wants to say, why did you do that? Why did you get captives? First, you should win a victory over non-believers, and then you can get captives. But at the beginning, it is not true. Allah Ta'ala criticized. If we say that whatever Prophet Muhammad did and said are from Allah, there is a problem when we consider this Quranic verse. Also, what does he say? The author, the Prophet apparently made a mistake by accepting ransoms for these prisoners. Okay. The case of blind man, another passage in the Quran, Ibn Umm Maktum, Abasa wa tawalla an ja'ahu al-a'ma wa ma yudrika la'allahu yazzakka. The Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, frowned, did like that, and turned away because there came to him the blind man, Ibn Umm Maktum. But what could tell you but that perchance he might grow in spiritual understanding? The narration says what happened. Ibn Umm Maktum wanted to learn Islam. Also, there was Walid ibn al-Mughira, Walid bin Mughira. He didn't want to learn Islam. He was an arrogant person, but he was influential one in Mecca. And Prophet Muhammad tried to preach Islam to Walid bin Mughira instead of Ibn Umm Maktum. Why? Maybe he thought that I can preach Islam to Ibn Umm Maktum later. No problem, because he wants to learn that. And he postponed his preaching to Ibn Umm Maktum. And Allah Ta'ala said that it is not true. Whoever wants to learn Islam, you should preach to him, not the arrogant one. So there is another criticism here. The author wants to say, if Allah sent everything and Prophet Muhammad did and said everything in accordance with Allah's teachings, as he has no wish, he can't do anything wrong as Allah Ta'ala governed his life, whole life. He was like a robot. It is not true. If it were so, there wouldn't be a passage like that in the Quran related to Ibn Maktum. These Muslims, and the author transmits us an approach now. These Muslims are also rejected Shafi'i. What did Shafi says? Al-Kitab wal-Hikmah in Quran, in the Quran. What is Hikmah? Wisdom. According to Shafi, Hikmah is Sunnah, Prophet's doings. All Muslims accept that? No. Hikmah, if you think properly, if you think in accordance with the Quranic teaching, okay, everything is okay. Allah Ta'ala wants to say so, Hikmah. But he says, no, the Prophet Muhammad's doings, the Prophet Muhammad's sayings are Hikmah, he says. Muhammad Abduh is he was a contemporary Muslim scholar, exegete. He died in 1905. He was an Egyptian scholar. He says, although he's Shafi as well, madhab, explained Hikmah as understanding the objectives of the Quran. So, as I have mentioned before, understanding the objectives on the Quran, if you read the Quran and understand properly, Hikmah, this is Hikmah, they say the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad. Do we need Hikmah in order to consider Prophet Muhammad's traditions and doings? No. Atiyu Allah wa Rasul. Atiyu Allah wa Atiyu Rasul. In the Quran, there are such ayahs. Allah Ta'ala orders us to obey Prophet Muhammad as well. Not only his book, also Prophet Muhammad. So the Sunnah is obligatory. The hadith of Prophet Muhammad are obligatory, no problem. But are they obligatory as the Quranic teachings, Quranic verses? No. Quran has got an upper position and the Sunnah is on the second level. Okay. Next one will be Ahmed Han, another contemporary Muslim scholar. We will talk about his approaches to the Quranic verse, inshallah, in our next lesson. See you. Peace be upon you.